humans are imperfect. So I made this series, and I started this series prior to when the protests about George Floyd and the hundreds of other Black Americans that have been killed by police brutality began. Black Americans have been experiencing something for their entire lives and their parents' lives and their grandparents' lives. And a lot of people are just waking up to it. And I hope they stay awake. And I hope that moments like these hit our national consciousness in a way that we remember. I believe that Black lives matter, and I believe that what is happening now is just the match that starts a fire. And I hope that fire doesn't go out, because we need it. We need to burn away the things that are antithetical to our values. All people are created equal, all of them. We just don't treat them that way. And we should. I don't know how to properly transition from what's going on in the world to what's going on here on my channel, but our goal should be to better understand each other and where we're coming from, not to ignore or diminish each other. That's not what we're about. I have put down in the description a few different places where you can find more information and learn how to be better. I know I'm learning, and it is a process that we will be learning for quite some time, but we can do it together. We can do it together. Follow the Black and STEM hashtags. Follow Black and STEM on Twitter. Let's elevate voices that need to be heard. I really do hope that you enjoy the series. There may be some people who think, oh, leaving Earth? I would like to do that right now. So hopefully that speaks to you as well, even though that was not the intent when I started putting this together. Thanks again for being a subscriber, for watching Una Dose of Trace. Thanks. Y'all, space is dangerous. People have died getting there and getting home, and even while in space. Space is harsh. It degrades our bodies and it corrupts the building blocks of life. It even makes simple tasks that you and I can do here on Earth difficult. Space is beautiful. Achievements in space are celebrated by all of us everywhere in the world. The vastness and variety of space promises an eternity of exploration. Space is the future. We cannot live on this planet forever. We simply cannot. Zoom out in our timeline as far as you want, and at some point we either have to leave or we die here. We have to go to space. We have to become multiplanetary. We have to leave Earth. But how do we do that? I got you, fam. One of the oldest films our species created was based on an even older story. It's considered the first sci-fi film. It's called Le Voyage dans la Lune. Humans build a giant cannon and they shoot explorers to the lunar surface. It's a pretty awesome film if you haven't seen it, it's not very long, and it was created in 1902. Space habitation has been imagined by humanity since the mid to late 1800s. In 1903, author Konstantin Tsiolkovsky created this idea of a rotating space station that would generate its own gravity. We've had ideas like solar energy, greenhouses for food. This was all from him over 100 years ago. We've wanted to leave this planet for so long. And the question isn't if we leave, but when we leave and how, right? So unless you're in the why camp, you know, why would we leave? If you're there, let's, you know, bring you out of it. The simplest answer of why we should leave is that all birds leave the nest. In 1883, Krakatoa in Indonesia erupted. Erupted might not even be the right word. It exploded with the fire of 1,000 hells, 13,000 times larger than the Hiroshima bomb. It was heard 5,000 kilometers away in Australia. Shockwaves from this explosion circled the planet 7 times. Everything on the island was destroyed. Everything. There were no plants, no insects, nothing. Because there were other islands around Krakatoa, though, species were able to catch the wind and return to the island. Just a few years after this explosion that decimated everything, not decimated actually, zero-mated, I don't know what everything is, just completely made all life extinct on that island. Small plants, insects, and trees had all come back. Several years later, medium-sized animals started to return. 50 years after this giant volcanic explosion, there were hundreds of species on the island, and that is because they had little lifeboats. Life was elsewhere, and it could repopulate. Supervolcanic activity like this could happen worldwide eventually, or an asteroid could hit us again. 99% of all species on the planet are already extinct, actually 99.9%. There are a multitude of reasons to leave our planet, but here are a couple of my favorites. Our sun is 4.6 billion years old. It's a main sequence star, and it's gonna flame out in a few billion years. Earth will boil and go bye-bye. If we don't have volcanoes or asteroids destroying the planet, the core could cool enough to lose our magnetic field. We could just destroy ourselves with climate change. We are all on the same island right now. If there is a disaster, we all die, and there's no one to carry on or repopulate. If some of us are somewhere else, our species, our life on this planet, could live. Another reason why I think we should explore space, aside from just satisfying this emotional curiosity that humans have, is that the problems that you come up with in space, the problems that you come up against, survival in small groups, conflict resolution, understanding how resources need to be managed, all of that helps you live in space, but can be brought back and used to make the Earth better. For example, using energy that is renewable, getting energy from the sun that the sun is just throwing off constantly, that solar energy has been powering the International Space Station, and that has happened completely off of the grid. And that is possible because of the technological advances that were made in order to create it, and we can bring that technology back here to the Earth and make Earth cleaner and better support all of the people that live here. So we should leave Earth, because in the challenge of leaving this cradle of our humanity, we will make the cradle better. That's my favorite reason for leaving. Sure, asteroids, the sun's gonna explode. The heat death of the universe is inevitable. No matter where we go, we can't run from that. But we can't sit in the cradle because that's comfortable. We have to eventually go. In 1975, there was stuff on the moon. We'd left golf clubs and poop and retroreflectors and lunar cars, and those visits changed the world. It made people think differently about our tiny little teeny planet here. Sci-fi author and biochemist Isaac Asimov and physicist Gerard O'Neill sat on the couch in a 1975 episode of PBS Roundtable, and they talked about creating habitable cities in space.
We have got out the full enormity of the plan that you have in mind. How many people would this one hold, Model 1?
The very first one, Mr. Hayes, might be 10,000 people. It might be four little villages of perhaps 2,500 people in each. It's the total population being perhaps 10,000 people.
I see. Now, how do these people live within this cylinder?
Well, they would be growing crops by normal agriculture, although quite intensively, because of the fact that the weather would be controllable and the length of the day would be controllable, the seasons
no droughts,
would be controllable.
No insect pests. We'd call the Earth the old country.
Right.
And that was in 1975. It's been 45 years since then. The plan was then to establish a moon base and mine the moon for materials, to use 70s technology to lift materials to Lagrange points, which are different gravitational parking spots around the moon and Earth. And at those spots, you could put something that just hangs in space and it doesn't move relative to the Earth and the moon. It appears to be stationary, and you could live there. We obviously, you know, didn't do that. It's amazing that we went to the moon 45 years ago, and we are still talking about it today, all the time. While researching this episode, I watched a show called Return to the Moon, and it said that the moon is filled with resources. We could think of it as basically the eighth continent. So cool, right? This show is only on CuriosityStream. They helped sponsor this video, so thanks to them. We've been pandemicking for like a while now, and during this time, CuriosityStream wants to keep your brain engaged, which I fully identify with. There are so many different shows that you can do that with on CuriosityStream, like The Art of the Heist, which is about high-profile art thievery, or How the Internet Changed the World with Bay Derek Muller. CuriosityStream is fact-based escapes from the norm, which I love. I still want to be more entertained, but I want it to be truthful. If you use the link on the screen or down in the description, you're gonna get Curiosity Stream Plus, you're gonna get Nebula. Nebula is a brand new streaming service that I started with a bunch of other creators, and we put all of our content there for you. We wanted a place that if you join, you would support us directly and you'd get to see videos from thoughtful and smart and fun creators that we all love. We even get to pool resources to create our own originals and try really cool things like the history of synths or breaking down our favorite title sequences or exploring the history of World War II. We've done a lot on Nebula and there's gonna be so much more, so you should join. So recap, get Curiosity Stream, you get that annual subscription, it's only $2.99 a month, and you get big budget nonfiction. Plus, if you use my code, you get a free month to start. And as long as you have Curiosity Stream, you get Nebula for free too, which supports us creators directly. Just visit curiositystream.com/trace, use that promo code trace. You're gonna get Nebula and Curiosity Stream together so you can stay home and stay curious. But, you know, let's go back to the moon. Mining the moon is still a thing. We're still interested in that. We've got moon rocks. They're made of similar stuff to the rocks here on Earth, but they have more titanium in them. They're actually 10 times more titanium than Earth, and refining those materials requires a vacuum. And on Earth, we'd have to build a big room and suck all the air out of it, but on the moon, we can just mine. It's already in a vacuum. The moon has iron and oxygen, chlorine and lithium, beryllium, zirconium, uranium, thorium, rare earth elements used for electronics. It even has water and helium-3, a super rare form of helium that's very useful. And that's not the only place that we can leave to. There are asteroids. We could live on an asteroid. Some are ice, some are collections of pebbles and rocks. Some have water or iron or other rarer minerals. We could hollow them out and live on the inside. We could make them into mines and bring the resources back. Spaceflight feels easy, it feels safe, and we're really good at it. But it ain't safe or easy, and we're actually not that great at it. Last weekend, amidst widespread unrest across the United States, humans launched into space on a private space vehicle, the first time that had ever happened. Sidebar, Black Lives Matter. Now, I say we're bad at space because it took us 9 years to make that happen after the space shuttles were retired. We only ever built 6 space shuttles, and they cost so much money, $450 million every single time we launched one. And if you want to leave Earth, we're going to need to do better. Need to make it easy and cheap to do. And again, why? Maybe you're still asking. Let me reframe this for you. Many of us around the world are sequestered in our homes, feeling that itch to go outside, to go on a balcony or in a yard, to go to the stoop or the street and just get outside a little bit, right? Just a taste of that outside world. Think of it this way. The International Space Station is our balcony, our stoop. The moon is our backyard. We smelled the air in the 1960s and 70s. We saw the horizon, and we cannot stay inside forever. We must eventually go into the yard, go out and explore. So if we wanna leave and we wanna grab these minerals to build our multiplanetary species, if we wanna figure out how to better explore the universe, how do we do it? How do we leave? This whole series is gonna dig deep into how we do all of these different things, because let's face it, we gotta do it. So stick around so you get all the episodes in this series. We can figure out how we're gonna leave, where we should live, and how we're gonna get to another star. So again, stick around, subscribe, and I will see you in the future.